opportunity to invite SUTD. So I think some of you may not know SUTD. We are still very new and we still have a lot to learn from the other universities. It's a Singapore University of Technology and Design. I'm from the Information System Technology and Design. I'm one of the lecturers there. I'm teaching the Freshmore course. So we call it Freshmore because it's not really a freshman and it's taking part some time in the sophomore. So we call it a Freshmore because it takes like 3 terms for all the students coming to SUTD. And for all students coming to SUTD, they have to take all these foundations. So they take all the basic mathematics, they take physics, and one of the foundations is actually computation. So all students, they have to take computing. And this is the course that I'm going to share with you how we teach computing for all courses. Now generally, so as some of the speakers has mentioned, the capability range a lot, especially for those who are interested in this architecture. So they really ask questions why they have to learn computing. But in our curriculum, even the second year and pillar courses, they actually use C# to do some of the architectural computation. So it is a must for every student to learn computations, even for the engineering product development. It's very confusing because we don't use like electrical and mechanical and this kind of thing. But this is actually something like electrical and mechanical schools. Engineering system and design, something like industrial engineering, financial engineering, and this kind of degrees. And information system is more like computer engineering, computer science, information systems. So if you take a look of the courses, the Freshmore is a common, and then they can go for their respective pillars, and on their respective pillar they can take their electives, and then the final year they will take their capstone projects. So I think the questions that we are asking when we set up this, where should we pitch our course at this age where MOOC has been taking over a lot of courses. And they can take the best courses from the best universities in the world. Are we still relevant? Are we still conducting lectures in a lecture theater like what we have here? And students sitting there listening, looking at the PowerPoint slides. How should we do it in teaching computer science? And even, you know, edX, Coursera, there's always computing courses, and they always provide Python. Some JavaScripts and these kind of things. So I think in this presentation, we're going to share how we do it, and we want to emphasize that it is still important to have a face-to-face learning, because some of the speakers has mentioned, it's actually the human interaction that creates the learning experience. Now, start with the student feedback. This is one of the student feedback. Of course, I take the good one. So they say it's fun and interesting course. And so these students have taken some courses from the MOOC. Coursera, edX, they have learned programming before. But I think what I'm very interested here that he said he still learned something here. It provides something that the online courses doesn't provide. They actually control something physical. I'm going to show it to you, some of the things that we do later on. And there's this 2D project. I'm going to mention about what is a 2D project. So design is one of our name in school. So every school, SUTD has the word design there. And in our pedagogy and curriculum, we have the big D design. I'm going to mention it, what is the big D design in SUTD. So one of the 2D challenges they have to control a program or about something like a Google self-driving car. And if you have your computer, you can go to these websites. This is our course websites. You can look at the class calendars to see what the topics, the learning objectives, and some of the resources there. So, now I think in many courses, even in SUTD, most of the time lectures has been the main thesis. And projects becomes the side thesis. So in our courses, we try to flip it around and to make the project as the main thesis. And the other things is supporting the project. So in a way, this creates more motivation for the students and they see the relevance to their engineering career and the real life applications. So we have a 1D, 2D, 3D, and 4D pedagogy. The 1D pedagogy is basically they have a design projects within a course. So in certain weeks in their courses, we have about like 14 weeks in a semester. For one subject, they have one design project, one design project, one design. This is what we call as a 1E. It's a design project within a course. And so in our course, Digital World, we call it the Digital World, we have several design projects starting from a very simple instruction. So we use films for the first half of the terms. Something just teaching them sequential logic. So ask the robots to move here and there depending on the sequential. Teaching them about functions. So on week 3, they have another design project. On week 4, they have another design project teaching about conditional iterations. On week 5 and 6, we give them something that's more open. Right? So we don't just want to give a specific task, but we want them to develop some creativity on what they want to do with the tools that they have. And then they move on to a different tools where they learn about state machines. So they started to make an autonomous robot, they learn how to control it. And on the last, they have another open project that is to create applications to teach the young computational thinking. One of the purposes, we want to teach them metacognitive, since they know what they need to know in learning computing. So these projects give the framework for all the other teachings that you are doing, and everything is directed toward them. Let me show you one of the open projects video that the students made. So in some of the weeks, we give them a specific task for them to do, and then after that, on the 6 weeks, then we give them an open project where they're allowed to solve certain problems or certain situations where they want to use the robots. So these are some of the instructors when they are marking the projects. So they need to do a check-off and interview with the instructor. They have to show the code, explain the code to the instructors. So one of the game, they maybe use the robot as a controller because it has an accelerometer. I think I'll stop here. So this is one of the professors also. What he's doing is actually he's giving a check-off after the students finish a project. So every student, they will have to explain the code to the instructors. Then we ask them questions just to make sure they understand. So for this student's project, it's 2 persons per team. So they have to do it in a pair. And each team, they are given a robot to do that. And how do we equip the students to do all these kind of projects? So this is what we are doing in a week, right? So we start with an online learning. If you go to the website that I show you just now, I think I have it here also. So we use an online, there's a free book called Think Python. I think some of you may know about it. And then there's an interactive Python that is based on Think Python. So we don't have a lecture in Digital World. And what the students have to do is that they have to learn it before they come to the class, before the week. So we have a list of chapters that the students have to go through before they come to these classes. And when they come to the classes, what happens is that on the first sessions, they'll have a micro quiz. This is the one that drives them to do this. If we don't have a micro quiz, they will not do it. Right? And then in the class, we spend most of the time to solve the cohort problems. So this is the part that we do the modeling, how we solve the problems we show them how to code on certain problems. Then they do their homework. At the end of the week, they have a programming quiz. So it's quite intensive because in 1 week, they have two quizzes. One is a reading quiz to make sure that they have done the online material. And then at the end of the week, they have a short programming quizzes to make sure that they have learned what they are supposed to learn. So the online material, the Think Python, is quite interesting. Some of you may have used it. Let me show you that I can show it here. So if you click some of the chapters here, it has a certain video online. So this is not developed by SUTD, it's available online. We just make use of it because we don't want to reduplicate what other people have been doing. So there's some video, and this is basically an online book, and it's actually an interactive book. So you can type your Python code here, you can click run, and then they'll show the code running on somewhere else, right? So the idea is that basically students, they have to do their own self-learning material before they come to the class. And actually we did a survey, and I was quite surprised also, right? Like 76 actually did the pre-reading materials. So some of my colleagues actually challenged me, they will not do that. But students are driven by grades, that's what we found. So they do it because they want to do the micro quiz. So a lot of them do it before the class, some of them do it after, some of them before and after. Only this 4%, they never done anything. And I think it has a certain advantage for the students as well as for the lecturers. The students are more attentive because they have a prior knowledge, and we learn that also in our educational theory that they need a prior knowledge before they come to the class so that they are more attentive, they can learn better. And in the class, they can discuss something that is more complex, they can have a more meaningful discussions. And some of the students who are faster, they can just go ahead because it's up to their own pace. So this is to handle the variety of capabilities among the students, because some of the students, they have learned programming before. Some of the students, they have not learned anything at all, and this is the first time they do it. So you bore some of the better students, but with this approach, it seems that those better students, they can just keep going ahead, and then they can help others during the class. And then, I like the future tense here. I think this is something that we want to change the attitude of the students. So next time, in whatever courses they do, they will not go to the class without any background knowledge. And so during the micro quiz, the first lessons that they do, they'll have a micro quiz, simple MCQ questions, just to make sure that they do the online reading. We have an online system that can give them an immediate feedback. So this one, we call it the concept quiz. It's one of the example. After they do a chapter on functions, then they'll be tested what is a function and these kind of things. So they can see their answers immediately, whether they are right, whether they are wrong. So that's for the micro quiz. And then during the cohort, basically they are doing a cohort problems. So we don't have lectures, as I mentioned. We have about 40 students in a cohort, 40 to 50 students in a cohort, and we have three instructors in a cohort. So in the last term, we have two faculty and one teaching assistant. So this is one of the faculty. Maybe the other faculty is taking photo, I don't know. But basically they are group in small groups, and they can help one another. They are doing problems during the cohort sessions. So the faculty will introduce the first problem, they will ask the students to do it, they will go around and help the students. And I think like what the blog mentioned, the best way to learn programming is actually to program it. And so we want to spend most of the time in the class, not just listening to lectures, but also to program. This is the place where we can give feedback immediately, teach them how to program, what are the common mistakes, and this kind of thing. And then they submit their lessons to an online system also, where they can get an immediate feedback, some of the test cases also here. So they do this for the cohort sessions, they do this for the homework, they do this for the programming quizzes, they can get their scores immediately. Some of the questions that we gave, it's very difficult to grade automatically. So we have what we call as a check-off. So the check-off means that the students will have to present it to the instructors, and then the instructors will ask them questions, right? So for example, like problem of a flowchart, then we can give them a one-to-one feedback. Oh, this is where you make mistakes, this is the way that the flow should be, and this kind of things. So certain problems, we do it face-to-face, and we do it by check-off, so the staff, the faculty will enter the password and enter the grades. So we have all these continuous assessments. Every week we have a micro quiz, programming quiz, core session homeworks, and one projects. And this is the average and the median score normalized to 100 for all the students. And I think they did pretty well. They did pretty well. So the micro quiz, most of them is almost like 90 plus. It means that they are doing the reading. The programming quiz is slightly lower because of course it's a different skill than just an MCQ. Cohort sessions, because we discuss it in class, they do it, we expect all of them get almost high, except some who never attend the class. The homeworks, it's a bit difficult to say because some of them they copy. So, but the 1E projects, this is the part that we check them off. So we know them individually, what they are doing, and some of the 1E projects, they are open projects, so each thing will be different. So we know roughly where they are, and we can give them feedback immediately. So they did pretty well for the 1E projects. So this is one of the final 1E projects where we asked them to create a game for computational thinking. These are some of the different games, something like from a simple logic game, some algorithmic thinking, where they have to flip up until everything is lined up, some like sequential logic where they have to start from one place, following the flow of the water. So they made up these games. We never tell what kind of game they should make, but I think it's something that we want them to think, what is computational thinking? So after they learn programming skills and so on, we want them to teach, because one of the things that we learn, the best way to learn is by teaching to others. We also have a 2D projects, and it's quite an amazing project for digital world and for term 3. So 2D project is a project that is across the subjects within that semester. So this is an example. Let's say in one semester they have math, physics, chemistry, and humanities subject. So on certain weeks they will have a common design project that involves all the subjects. So this is to show the students that actually all the subjects are related. You need to study all this. And in this world, everything is getting more multidisciplinary, and we want to show that relations. So this is one of the 2D challenges that we have in 2013. We call it the milk delivery system. They are studying biology, physics. Biology, physics, system world is basically mathematics and the digital world. So the design task is basically we want to create an autonomous system to deliver milk. And they have to start by doing research on biology, on the freshness of milk. So this is where they do experiments with bacteria, and they will determine the time of the freshness of milk on a certain temperature that will determine the heat transfer property of the physics project. They have to build a small fridge using some incubator. They learn about heat transfer. They learn also about thermocouples, where they have to transfer the heat to be an active cooler. And then in the system walls, they try to optimize the path. They're given a certain destination, certain numbers of bottles of milk they have to deliver, and they have to optimize it. So where do we have to go, at what time they have to go, and so on. So it's an open problem as well. And for the digital world, they have to implement it. So they have to control the robot, and they have to deliver it to all these destinations given an input base taken from the URL with a certain destination, a certain milk bottles, and basically they will have to deliver all these things. Depending on the time also that they have specified and learned from their previous experiments. So this is for the 2D project, but in some of the 1D project, we start them from a simple problems. So we teach them state machines, and the idea of teaching them state machines is basically to model of a system, and being able to, starting from a model of a state diagram, they are able to abstract it in a class, in an object, and then implement it in Python. So this is the final challenge that they have to do. It's a kind of a small world with a certain junctions. So they have to collect the milk from here, and then they have to deliver it at different positions, and then to control the robot autonomously. So what we did is that we have a simulator. So they start programming in a simulator, and then after that they test it in the real world. And I think one reason why we want to do this is because we want to model the engineering practices as well. I mean, like when you build an airplane, you don't just build an airplane immediately. You start with the modeling first. You start by simulating it first, then after that you test it and experimented with the real one, prototyping it, and so on. So they do learn this kind of processes. And I think they learn a very meaningful experience when they start from simulation to the real world, because it's a very different experience. So this is a video of the big challenge in 2013.
This project is a 2D challenge, and it requires the students to use the knowledge they have gained in 4 classes during the semester this term and complete the project. What you are seeing today is the second part of the project.
We are given a task in these 2D projects, and in this project, right, we are supposed to collect the milk carton for this collection point, and then we are supposed to send this milk carton to specific locations, which is A, B, and C.
There are 4 classes this term. What you are seeing here is based on what they have learned in the digital world course, which is control systems and Python programming, and what they have learned in the systems world course, which is path planning, optimization, and similar things.
Basically, for this project, we applied the concept of programming. So using knowledge that we acquired over the past term for programming, and also concepts from math, where we have to think of how to plan a route. Using those 2 concepts, we amalgamated it and then developed the code.
Currently, we are doing digital world projects, and one of the main things about these things is to do programming. So by doing this programming, we are given a robot. By using this robot information, decoding the sensor information and try to apply the actions to the robot itself.
For the first half of the time, we were doing basic Python programming learning, and then the second half, we were actually introduced the EnigoBot, which is what we're doing right here. Third level, we got like 1, 2, 3, 4 jumps inside there. So it's like a full, a small town. So you got collection points, and then you pick up milk, then you decide to go which junction to take to your destination. So in level 4, we have 2 collection points in the same maze as level 3. So the robot has to intelligently choose which one is the shortest path between the collection point and the destination.
The other 2 classes are biology and physical world. Those 2 classes, they correspond to the first phase of this project. The students completed that phase in week 10. And that phase required the students to understand what is the meaning of the freshness of milk. What does it mean about the bacteria, how long can the bacteria last, and so on. So the whole idea here is to build a complete system which includes the heating the milk and then putting it inside the insulator, and then putting the entire set of milk cartons on the robot and delivering it somewhere. The original idea was that suppose Singapore wants to do something like this for food, for all kinds of food delivery, and automatically using robots. So we actually, what they are doing is building a prototype of something like that.
Our group is actually one of the first few teams to finish this level 4 maze, and the experience we got from it is just different. You know, there are things out there in the real world, like designing Google car, programming it to drive in real world situations, like take junctions and stuff like that. This level 4 experience is really close to that. So before we took out the real maze and tried out the real robot, there's the simulation part going on. So on the computer, we actually tried out all the possible scenarios. But what we find was that when you move into the real situation, things are different. So you have to readjust yourself, your program, to the real situation that they're facing in the real world. Once you get to that level, then you're just fine.
Whatever they learned in the classroom, they actually applied that on the computer using a simulator. So what you're seeing here in the robots, they've actually done this work on the simulator. In almost all cases, the students are able to make the robot work on the simulator. But when they come here in real life, the robots don't work the way they work in the simulator.
So it is very tough, and then we spend about 1 day and one night to figure out state A and state B. But once we finish station A and station B, for station C and station D, it's about the same. We just need to recombine actions, so it will be much easier for us. I learned a lot from this, and it's a tough project, but I enjoy it very much.
From this project, because it's a good work, so we learn how to work with each other, and even though times are sometimes quite hard, we still we'll be very patient with each other, and basically try to integrate everything that we've learned so far. It's a very enjoyable experience.
Right, so I'll end that with that video, but I think one thing that we want to emphasize is that we're trying to provide a project-based learning, in the sense that we want to make the project to be something that is the main piece, and the other pedagogy is supporting the project so that they have motivations. So we have online learning, we did some core-based sessions, and I think the faculty interactions with the students are very important. We want to spend most of the time in the class where students can code and program so they can give feedback for the students. And I think they will learn a lot when they see how it is being applied into the real world and they can control, and actually engineering is very meaningful. Right, and I will be happy to take any questions. So we have two kind of robots. So this one is Finch, I think it's from the Carnegie game at Allen University. It's about $99, so it's quite cheap. This one is Amigo one, so this is a bit expensive. MIT use this, and because our curriculum is adopting from there, so we use this for some of our exercises. This is about 5K.
5K?
Yeah. Sorry?
What is the robot that used in the first video?
In the first video, it's called Finch. You can Google Finch robot and you'll see this Finch's robot. So, I think Carnegie Mellon designed this to teach computing, so it supported a lot of languages like Python, Java, C, and all these kind of things. And I think one reason why you use robot, because even the architecture students, they really enjoy playing with this because this is something tangible, the color change. They can use it and this kind of things.
Actually, we use it too, but use it Mindstorm.
Mindstorm? Yeah. It's for Lego.
Yeah.
Any other questions? If not, I don't want to delay your lunch. So I'll pass it back to organizer.